Now, Sunday night is music night.
Wow, 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 wow. Hello, I'm Jo Wiley and delighted to be with you for this very, very special edition of Sunday Night is Music Night. On the 23rd of November, 1963, a new show arrived on our television screens. No one could possibly have imagined that 60 years later, it would still be here, bigger and more spectacular than ever. Welcome to Doctor Who at 60, a musical celebration. Let's hear it for the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and the BBC Singers. All of them making that glorious sound under the direction of our conductor, Alistair King. And that was, quite fittingly, I Am the Doctor, composed, like so much of the music we'll be hearing tonight, by Murray Gold. This was created for The 11th Doctor, played by Matt Smith, with its distinctive riff to let us know that the Doctor had a plan, doesn't he always? Tonight we're here in the BBC's Hoddenot Hall in Cardiff, home of the BBC National Orchestra of Wales. It's a beautiful sounding room and the place where the musical soundtrack for today's Doctor Who is created. The orchestra is currently busy recording the music for next month's 60th anniversary specials and the 2024 series, something we'll be finding lots more about later in the show. The BBC National Orchestra of Wales made its first Doctor Who contribution to the 2006 Christmas special, The Runaway Bride. Who could ever forget Catherine Tate exploding onto our screens in a wedding dress without pockets as Donna Noble? Our next piece dates from 2007 and bears the perfect Doctor Who title, All the Strange, Strange Creatures.
Thank you.
called a strange, strange creature, something the Doctor has had more than his fair share of to contend with over the past 60 years. Of course, music has been such an important part of Doctor Who's success since it began back in 1963. When that very first episode opened with the otherworldly sounds conjured up by the BBC Radiophonic Workshop's Delia Derbyshire, no one could have been in any doubt that here was something out of the ordinary. Throughout the 1960s, 70s and 80s, the creative minds of the Radiophonic Workshop continued to provide us with Doctor Who's soundtrack. And I'm delighted to say the two of them are here with us tonight as they prepare to conjure up memories of the Sea Devils, Cybermen, the City of Death, and the Five Doctors. Please welcome Mark Ayres and Peter Howell.
Thank you. It's the end. But the moment has been prepared for.
National Orchestra of Wales with Mark Ayres and Peter Howell of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop. It's quite the entrance music, isn't it? That's what you want as you walk on. I'm delighted to be able to talk to you now, to Mark and to Peter. It's lovely to see you with your bank of electronics as well. And we're celebrating 60 years of Doctor Who tonight. And the sound and the music has always been such an important part of the show since the very first episode. Ron Grainer's theme, as brilliantly reimagined by Delia Derbyshire, was the first thing that everyone heard. For you, Peter, just how primitive back in the beginning was the sounds that were were made that the radiophonic workshop were dealing
well,
with?
Well, I mean, in the early days when Delia Derbyshire was making the theme music, the Ron Grainer Road, he went on holiday having written a couple of lines on some manuscript paper, and when he came back from holiday, he couldn't believe what she'd done. The effect was amazing. She was taking very, quite primitive sound sources. There was a sort of homemade guitar string thing, and oscillators that really didn't play individual pitches like a keyboard. You literally had just one sweep, and you had to choose each sound you wanted, recorded on tape, and then pitch the tape sometimes, if it was the pluck string, and then put it all back together again by editing the tape together. And it really was painstaking work. And she went to the most enormous amount of trouble to get the dynamics and everything in it. It's a wonderful, wonderful job.
I'd imagine there were miles of tape as well. I mean, where did you put that? Where did that go?
Well,
down the corridor.
Mark can tell you about that.
Mark, tell me, please.
Maida Vale had about the longest corridor in London. And if there was a wrong note, Dick Mills always used to say they used to stretch the tapes all the way down the corridor. And then you counted long. And when you saw the two edits which didn't match, that was the wrong note. So, but isn't it amazing that, you know, that music that she created back then is still underpinning what we hear 60 years later with the latest arrangement of the theme tune and everything? Yeah. It lasts. It's just magic.
I know that corridor very well. I was there just yesterday. I know how long that corridor is, so I can picture. I mean, it's long. It's very, very long. Yes. So tonight we do have our orchestra and the BBC singers, but it would be fair to say that the music budgets in the 60s and the 70s and the 80s well were a little bit more constrained, weren't they?
Yep. You could say that, yes. And also time as well. It wasn't just the budgets. I mean, if you were working on your own, you're under a lot of pressure to meet the deadlines. I mean, if there was an adventure, say an adventure had four episodes, your deadline for the first episode was a breeze because everybody thought it was going to go really well, you know, and they get along to the second episode and then something goes a bit wrong and, oh, sorry, we've delayed it a bit. But what didn't delay was the deadline. So what would happen is they would delay delivering it to me, but the deadline will remain the same. It's rather like sitting in a fast car going towards a solid brick wall.
I doubt much has changed, to be honest.
No, I don't think
has
much has changed.
Yeah, has it?
Changed.
I mean, tell us what it's like
I'm glad to say I don't do too much of it now. So.
Talking about budgets, you heard a bit of Curse of Fenric, which is one of the stories I did at the end there, and I wanted a soprano soloist to add to my synthesizers, and I was told no, there wasn't a budget for it. So to be here and hearing the BBC National Orchestra of Wales playing that music is such a thrill for us.
Yes,
it really
it's fantastic. I mean, it's a great privilege for us to be here and hear stuff that we wrote 35 years ago being realised in such a dramatic form. Brilliant.
It's rather emotional, isn't it?
Yes,
just being
it
here
is.
Tonight.
It's humbling and yeah.
Yeah?
Marvellous.
Yeah. Well, it's lovely to talk to you. Thank you so much, everybody. Mark Ayres and Peter Howell. We'll be meeting one of the titans of modern-day Doctor Who shortly, and that's after we listen to one of Murray Gold's best-known musical creations for Doctor Who. Abigail's Song was the song that Abigail Pettigrew sang in A Christmas Carol back in 2010. With her perfect voice, she was able to resonate the fog crystals in the skies above Sardic Town. This unlocked the clouds, created snow, and allowed an endangered spaceship carrying a honeymooning Amy Pond and Rory Williams to land safely on the planet. Here it is, featuring the equally perfect voice of the BBC singers Rebecca Lee.
Silence is all.
Abigail's song, Silence is All You Know. And we really should dedicate that performance to Sir Michael Gambon, who starred in A Christmas Carol and sadly just died. Michael Gambon, everyone. Please welcome the writer of A Christmas Carol and former Doctor Who showrunner, it's only Stephen Moffat. That is a beautiful piece of music, Stephen. As a writer, how much consideration do you give to what music can bring to the show?
Well, I just hope and pray it will play during the explanatory scenes quite loudly. In that case, that beautiful song there, I remember I just wrote it in the script. Could Murray just write a really good song here? So he did. That's one hell of a stage direction to give your composer.
And your involvement with Doctor Who goes back almost 20 years when you wrote for Christopher Eccleston and David Tennant's Doctors before you became the showrunner for the Matt Smith and the Peter Capaldi eras. So they are very, very different personalities, but they both became the Doctor. So how do you start writing for a Doctor?
I think you actually just write the Doctor. That's what you do. You just write the Doctor. I know what the Doctor sounds like. I know what the Doctor thinks, kind of, insofar as a human ever could. And you see how that plays out of someone's mouth. You know, with Matt, I noticed that you could make him as cold and dreadful as you like. He could do terrible things, and you'd still look into his big puppy eyes and say, oh, you're nice, aren't you? You're so sweet. You've betrayed everyone, but that's fine. He's doing that right now on Game of Thrones, isn't he? You go with him. You agree with Matt. It's like when he invites you on a night out and you say, yes, it's a bad idea. And then with Peter Capaldi, you suddenly realize you can put in as many goofy jokes as you like. He will still scare the crap out of you, right? So I remember just thinking, right, and I said it to the other writers, just, you know, as many jokes as you like, he's still going to go in, own the room, and consume the universe with eyebrows.
So which is your favorite Doctor? Because I know you're going to tell me.
I've given that. So, okay, I'm gone from the show. It doesn't matter anymore. I think having a... I think it's time to choose a favourite. My favourite is Doctor Who. Because, you know, says other doctors, they just like cure colds and stuff, right? Doctor Who, he fights monsters. So definitely Doctor Who, he's the best one.
We do
and
have
occasionally she.
We do have Sylvester McCoy in the audience here tonight. So
yeah.
It would have been
my favourite. Yeah. He's my favourite. He's my favourite.
Oh, and here he is, everyone. There's your doctor. So the 50th anniversary special, the Day of the Doctor,
yes.
that was a large responsibility, which must have been quite daunting.
It was absolutely terrifying. I don't think I had a happy moment for 2013 until it was over. But it was genuinely, absolutely gobsmackingly horrifying.
How did you approach it then?
With fear. I remember there was a point, it was only a few weeks out, we literally had no doctors at all. We had Jenna Coleman. I was saying she's been in it for 8 episodes. I think people are going to be cross. I love her, but that's not quite enough. Can we get a single doctor in this? We did finally, as you know.
How did you get those doctors?
By begging and pleading and talking down the phone and saying, no, you're my favourite and you can have all the best jokes and you'll probably defeat the Zygons probably in the pages I haven't written yet. Something like that.
But you did get Tom Baker in there.
Yes, Tom Baker was there. Yes, and that was a magisterial moment as he strode on. Yeah, and that was brilliant. It was fantastic just when you first hear that voice. Mark Gatiss told me when he saw Day of the Doctor in the BFI. And it had been going well. It had been playing well. You know, people had been very thrilled and very excited to see all the stuff we had. And then you suddenly hear Tom Baker's voice saying, yes, I really think you might. And this man who'd be sitting in front of Mark Gatiss just went, oh, no, I can't take any more. And I thought, yes, that's it. That's what I want out of my television life.
We're about to hear another two pieces created for the Doctor by Murray Gold. This is Gallifrey and The Rings of Akaten, the love song. And this is your era, isn't it? Tell us about
The Long Song. There's a god awakening on a star. And, of course, because it's Doctor Who, you have to sing to it. You wouldn't do that in Star Trek, right? They'd have lasers. But we had some nice singing because we're British and we're Doctor Who.
That's what we do. Stephen, it's so lovely to talk to you. Delighted that you're here on this very special occasion. Stephen Moffat, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
hear them singing. One of Matt Smith's most dramatic moments as the Doctor. It was recalled there in the long song from the Rings of Akaten and brought to life for us by the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and the BBC Singers. Since the earliest days of the series, Doctor Who's companions have always played a crucial role. Through their eyes, we learn much more about who the Doctor really is. And through the companions, the Doctor sees all of humanity. When Doctor Who returned to our screens in 2005, Billy Piper joined the Doctor in the TARDIS as Rose Tyler, and a new generation of viewers travelled with her. Martha Jones, Donna Noble, and Amy Pond followed. So in celebration of them and featuring all of their themes, this is the Companion Suite.
Thank you.
Memories of Four Companions, Rose, Martha, Donna and Amy, and composed by Murray Gold. We're about to meet someone who has just been playing alto saxophone with the orchestra in that piece, but she has also played a crucial role in the world of Doctor Who in recent years, as we're about to find out. Please, a big welcome for Emily Cook. That's a new one for the CV then, playing with the National Orchestra of Wales.
I know, I've never had a saxophone lesson in my life. I'm self-taught. It's ridiculous.
So playing the saxophone isn't what you do full-time, is it?
No.
In fact, Doctor Who has taken up a lot of time recently, and lockdown was the pivotal moment. Will you tell us?
Yes. Basically, I just encourage Doctor Who fans to watch Doctor Who during lockdown. And Doctor Who fans don't take much encouraging to watch Doctor Who. But I coordinated fans watching together at the same time on the same day, the same episode. And it grew and grew and grew and became this massive thing that the stars of the show were joining in with, the creatives, the writers. And it was a big thing. We used social media for the power of good in lockdown.
Where did you get the idea from? I presume a long-time Doctor Who fan.
A long-time Doctor Who fan, yeah. I sat down in 2005 to watch Rose, the same year that I got my saxophone, actually. The idea for the tweed salongs really just came from me sitting at home wanting to watch Doctor Who. My housemates didn't want to watch with me. So I thought, I want to find some people to watch with. I wonder if there are any people out on the Twitter sphere. And there were quite a few, apparently.
Yeah, I understand completely. We're about to enter a new era of Doctor Who with the 60th anniversary episodes and a new series on the horizon with Russell T. Davies back on board. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that none of this would have happened if it wasn't for you. Do you think that's fair?
I don't know what to say, Joe. It's quite
How have you enticed him back?
It's quite overwhelming and amazing and magical, and it's hard to know what to say. I think it's just the power of Doctor Who. I think I'm standing here first and foremost as a Doctor Who fan. I know Russell is that too. And a lot of people that work in and around the show are obviously the fans. I think the fans are the second beating heart of the show. And it's something that never leaves you. And lockdown was such a strange time for all of us. And nobody that joined in with those tweet-alongs had ever forgotten what the show meant to them. But it was just something quite special and magical. And I think it's amazing that Russell and everyone has come back. And I can't quite process the fact that I had a part to play.
It's a very special community and it's lovely to be part of it, as we all are here today, I think, all of us. And your biggest collaborator on the lockdown sing-alongs that happened was Doctor Who fan and German guitarist Borna Matosic, who is here tonight, I'm delighted to say is here. Have the two of you met before?
No, this is the first time we met. So Borna reached out to me in lockdown and we collaborated on this sing-along idea, as well as the tweet-alongs. We thought, why don't we get Doctor Who fans to sing together? Because as we've heard, there are songs that have got these beautiful lyrics, and Bourne is incredible, an incredible musician. And we, yeah, amazingly, fans around the world were singing in English and in Latin, amazingly. And it was quite a powerful thing. And we hadn't met, we did everything on Zoom, everything virtually. So we were chatting earlier and saying, this is kind of mad, isn't it?
And here we are today. Emily, thank you so much for joining us. Emily Cook, everybody. And we're about to hear Borna right now with the BBC National Orchestra of Wales in a piece written for the final episode of Series 2. This saw Rose ripped apart from the Doctor, leading to an emotional farewell on a Norwegian beach on a parallel planet Earth. Of course, all filmed right here in Wales. Described by Murray Gold as representing Rose's unbridled energy and determination as she searches for the Doctor. This is Doomsday.
Thank you.
Doomsday. And the sound of a million hearts breaking as we watched that emotional farewell. I never wanted to relive that, but there we go. I'm Jo Wiley, and tonight, Sunday night, is Music Night, celebrating 60 years of Doctor Who and the impact of its wonderful music. It's coming to you from the Hoddinott Hall in Cardiff, that's where we are. This is home to the BBC National Orchestra of Wales, who've been joined by the BBC Singers. And it's the singers who are in the spotlight as we prepare to end part one of the concert with Valet Dacham, meaning Farewell 10. This was created by Murray Gold for the climax of David Tennant's 10th Doctor in The End of Time, Part 2. As ever, he tries to resist his inevitable regeneration with the unforgettable and heartbreaking words, "I don't want to go."
Celebration on Radio 2 and BBC Sounds.
Welcome back to Doctor Who at 60, a musical celebration. The BBC National Orchestra of Wales opening the second part of tonight's concert as they posed the question, a good man? Peter Capaldi's arrival as the 12th Doctor in 2013 found him struggling with a crisis in confidence. As he battled with his understanding of what it means to be a good man, Murray Gold's heroic theme hinted at a complex and somewhat troubled character. For the 2017 Christmas special, Twice Upon a Time, he helped the first Doctor, brilliantly played by David Bradley, to understand that he has been a good man and should continue his life. Let's hear how Murray Gold handled this emotional scene as the first Doctor regenerates in I Am a Good Man. Good man. The dramatic departure of Peter Capaldi's 12th Doctor, Doctor I Let You Go, and the first appearance of the 13th Doctor, played by Jodie Whittaker, marked a regeneration in more ways than one. Stephen Moffat stepped aside after six series, and Chris Chibnall took over as showrunner, himself no stranger to Doctor Who as a writer. As well as Jodie Whittaker, Chris made another major creative decision, the introduction of a new composer, Segun Akinola. I'm delighted to say they are both here with us tonight, so let's welcome them now. It's so great to see you and to have you here tonight, Chris and Segun. Now, when you were first approached, Chris, about running Doctor Who, how long approximately did it take you to say yes?
Well, there's sort of two hairs running at the same time there, one of which is, I mean, yes, absolutely, and the other one which goes, oh, my goodness me, the workload, absolutely not. and so it was a bit of, it was both, really, because, you know, I'd seen Russell and Stephen doing the job, I'd written episodes, I knew what it meant, and so I knew the workload, but then also I've been a Doctor Who fan since I was four. So it's a job that it's both irresistible and you take a deep breath and then you surrender to the joy.
But the level of scrutiny when you're running Doctor Who is something else, surely.
I'd not noticed it. No, was there any commentary? I never noticed it. Yeah, it is. You know that going in, and I knew particularly what we were going to do was going to attract more scrutiny with the first female doctor. But that's the fun of it, right? That's the thing when you're doing something new, you're trying things out. You go in with knowing you have to put your suit of armour on and pull your helmet down and do the thing you want to do creatively.
You also brought in our other guest, Sagan, who we're going to talk to right now. You brought him on board. How did you find out about his work?
I listened to a lot of composers and his work that he'd been doing on documentaries, and he came highly recommended from a number of different sources and his name kept coming up. So I listened to a lot and thought, oh, wow, he's really interesting.
I mean, Sagan, this is a very high-profile job that you took on pretty early on in your career. Yeah. Doing a high-profile show like this week in, week out, how was that for you?
I kind of describe it like a dose of terror filled with a little bit more terror and then a little bit of encouragement from Chris and then a bit more terror. And then eventually you're like, well, I need to get the job done. So you kind of just have to carry on with it.
Yeah, and the demand, I mean, it's very, very high pressure, isn't it? Having to deliver, as we heard earlier on.
Yes, yeah. Lots and lots and lots of music.
Lots of deadlines.
Yeah, lots of deadlines and then a bit more music.
And a bit more terror.
Yeah.
And how much of your own musical personality are you able to bring to something, to these creations?
Well, for me, it's something that I really have to kind of credit to Chris and also to Matt Strevens, who's somewhere over there, because they were really great in just saying, just do you. You know, there was no kind of sense of you have to do this or that. They said, just do what you want to do, and hopefully it'll work. And I think they think it worked. So,
it did.
Yeah.
It did. Yeah.
So you had creative freedom. How wonderful
was
that?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm delighted to say that you've created this brand new suite of your Doctor Who compositions, especially for tonight's concert for us all here. And it's very first performance. So just tell us a little bit what we can expect.
So that, you can definitely hear the Doctor's theme, The Woman Who Fell to Earth. There's music from Spyfall. There's music from The Power of the Doctor, and a few surprises as well. I don't want to give everything away, so a few things. Okay. Hopefully you enjoy.
We are very much looking forward to it. So for now, thank you very much indeed, Chris Chibnall and Sagan Akinola. Wow. The first performance of Segun Akinola's suite, The Woman Who Fell to Earth, performed by the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and the BBC Singers, directed by Alastair King. Doctor Who fans have so much to look forward to. Next month, there will be three specials as David Tennant and Catherine Tate make their return. And next year, the 15th Doctor, Shuti Gatwa, will be assuming control of the TARDIS. And of course, he will have a new companion, Ruby Sunday, played by Millie Gibson, joining him on his adventures. And we are about to unveil her theme right here, right now, for the very first time. We are! Composed by the newly returned Murray Gold, this is a gorgeous sounding waltz featuring Catherine Rowe Williams at the piano, The Life of Sunday.
Thank you.
beautiful, beautiful sounds there in the life of Sunday. And you might have heard that someone, or might have guessed that someone's joined me up here right now. It's only Murray Gold. What is this? What a treat to have you here. You've now been fully restored to the worlds of Doctor Who. Describe what it's like. Is it like a homecoming?
I guess it kind of is a bit like a homecoming. When you move back into a house you don't quite recognise anymore. You know, the furniture is mostly still in the same place.
It's just been moved around a little bit. And you'll get used
to it. New paintings on the wall. Somebody plays cricket in the back garden when before it was football.
How was that for you, listening to that?
That was quite exciting, actually. I don't think we've ever played a bit of music before it's actually gone on. It's sort of a bit of a one-off.
Sounds quite wistful.
Actually, I got to say, it's a bit of a two-off. Wink.
When you get to work on something like that, and you're working with Russell T. Davies, do you get a steer from the man himself, or is it just literally a blank sheet of paper?
You could call
it. Russell waves.
You could call it a steer. I mean, Russell knows what he likes, let's put it that way.
And do you listen to him?
It would be rude not to, wouldn't it? Russell and I have a shorthand that has, you know, developed over a really long time. I was speaking to some of the people in the audience in the interval, and they said, I've grown up with your music. I was like, that can't be possible. I only started in 2005. That was only, 18 years ago. Okay. It is possible.
You've been well known for creating character themes or motifs for the best part of 20 years, just to reiterate that.
Right.
So, whose idea was that initially?
Wagner's?
But in this universe that we're talking about, the Doctor Who universe.
Well, you know, I mean, honestly, I would blame Billy Piper for that, in a way. You know, when Christopher Eccleston came onto the screen, he did actually have a theme immediately, but it was almost not until Billy Piper's radiant smile staring out at the universe and then deciding that the one thing she'd really like most is a bag of chips. the themes of Doctor Who really sort of started to land and, just cohere with the characters.
And how do you approach it when you've got a character? And
how do they walk? How do they talk? What are they like? Do I like them? Are they sweet? Are they unsavory? Like Matt Smith's like 7/4 beat thing was just all about his gangly walk, you know. It just sort of comes to you and it like either works or it doesn't.
15, the new Doctor's theme.
Oh yeah.
We're gonna hear that as well.
Are we? Okay.
How much of a clue is the music to his character? What does this give to us?
It tells you that he's definitely the Doctor. So that's not a secret, is it?
No.
No, okay.
What kind of a doctor would you say?
One that goes running around all over the universe a lot, dragging people with him. It's just a sort of wonderful character. His whole soul just projects out of his face.
I can't wait to hear this bit of music now.
Oh, well, it's not in the music, but, you know. It's just in the acting.
It's lovely to talk to you. Murray Gold, everyone. Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. We get it. I think the Hooniverse is in safe hands. It's all going to be okay. Lenny Sayer on bass clarinet and David Miller on baritone saxophone in Murray Gold's brand new theme for the 15th Doctor. Coming to your screens for this year's Christmas special. As we look ahead to the return of Doctor Who for three 60th anniversary specials next month, no celebration could be complete, one like this, without us hearing from the one and only Russell T. Davies. Here he is. Oh, Russell, what a night.
Well, I think you can hear from the 15th Doctor's theme that we're coming back subtler than ever.
Do you think?
Isn't that great? I love that music.
I think we get an idea of his character then. How would you describe his character?
Oh, it's too soon, Joe. Don't do this to me. It's too soon. But, I mean, you've seen a lot of Shooter. You can tell a lot from him. But honestly, save the surprise. And we've got the 14th Doctor coming back first. Don't rush.
Okay.
How many times do I tell you, Joe, don't rush?
I've been doing this all my life, trying to ask you questions, trying to get the secrets out of you, and you never do. You never do. Going back almost 20 years to when you first relaunched Doctor Who, let's do that, after a 16-year gap, did you have a clear idea of how you wanted the music to sound?
Well, yes, we knew we wanted a big, full-blooded production. I worked a lot with Murray Gold. I worked with Murray on Queer as Folk back in 1999, and we love each other. We simply, he's nuts, and I love him. And actually, we're so lucky tonight with Sagan here. I worked with Ben Foster as well on Tortured, and a fantastic man called Sam Watts on the Sarah Jane Adventures, who now does the music to The Traitors. You listen to that music, it's very Doctor Who-y, actually. It's very dramatic and full and brilliant. And so it's a gift, it's a joy of my life to work with these people, because I think, actually, they've all got something in common, I think Murray is so brilliant at this that the music kind of gets to the heart of what's going on. Basically, it's not about those actors yapping away with the dialogue. What's so brilliant about listening to the band tonight is I wish it was always this full volume. I wish it was this loud. And we just did away with the dialogue. And one year, right, okay, series, let me think, series four. Okay, I'm going to write an episode that's all music with no dialogue.
Series four, so you're going to be doing it.
Well, we planned ahead.
Four
we want series. Series three. There's no room in series three.
He's doing four series. We've got that.
All right. We should do that.
So the big news is that you are now back in charge. Was it a no-brainer for you to come back?
It was a bit. It's like with all. I mean, the truth is, I remember Doctor Who when I'm like 3 years old. I visually remember it. So when you leave the job and someone says, "Will you ever write a Doctor Who story again?" You're kind of contractually obliged to say no, because there's someone else doing the job. But it never goes. It's like thinking. It's like breathing. Of course, I think of Doctor Who stories all the time. And the BBC had decided to set up a whole great big new future with it, independent of me. That was their idea to take it to a streamer, to make it bigger, to launch it internationally, to increase the budget. And I was very excited by that. I thought that's genuinely a great plan. I thought that's what the programme deserves. I also actually genuinely thought the programme will need someone who knows it looking after it. It was a bit scary, the thought of it going out into the future with someone who didn't know that there are rules, there are things you can do, there are things you can't do. And pushing against those rules is part of the job as well. But I was really keen to kind of make sure it didn't just get thrown to the lions, as it were. So I make myself sound marvellous, don't I? Hooray! I'm just brilliant, hooray!
You sound almost like the Doctor.
Yeah, but it was a joy, absolute joy. We've had so much fun.
I mean, Doctor Who is now 60 years old. Why do you think it is still so successful?
It's so unique. There's actually nothing like it. It's quite amazing in its entire history that nothing's come along and copied it. You can look at a lot of science fiction shows, look at vampire shows and zombie shows. They're all kind of related to each other. There is nothing like this. No one's actually copied it because it's nuts, because it's strange, it is eccentric, it is absolutely unique. And I think that calls out to you when you're 8 years old and beginning to realize that you're unique, sometimes you think you're the only person in the world, sometimes you think you're the only person who can think. And round about that time, you see this very individual show with a very remarkable lead character, whether it's a man, it's a woman, it's just so unique. And I think something wraps itself into your soul at that age and never lets go. And may it never let go.
Please, for the wonderful Russell T. Davies, thank you so much.
Thank you.
The Shepherd's Boy, one of Murray Gold's best-loved pieces of music for Doctor Who. And what an ending as the 12th Doctor finally breaks out of his confession dial after being trapped for billions of years. Where else do you find storylines like that? I'm Jo Wiley, and for me, speaking as a long-time Whovian, like lifetime Whovian, it's been the biggest privilege to be here tonight to celebrate 60 years of a uniquely British institution in this special concert at the Hoddenot Hall here in Cardiff. Thank you to all our guests and the stars of the show, the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and the BBC Singers, conducted by Alistair King. Thanks also to everyone at Bad Wolf Productions, BBC Studios, and our own Radio 2 team who have worked tirelessly to make this happen. And, of course, look out for those Doctor Who specials coming to our screens very soon. It's all looking very promising. Of course, we couldn't possibly leave you without hearing the iconic theme that has heralded every single episode of Doctor Who for the past 60 years. And that's exactly what we're about to hear for the very first time in its latest incarnation for 2023. I know, right? Good night.